Okay, so welcome to the final session, the rare all-male panel. And I would be sexist to say that men go to war and tell war stories, so I won't say that. But this is the story of the Essilor Luxottica deal, which was announced in January 2017 and received its final competition clearance last month, almost 2 years later. To bring the deal into slightly sharper focus, Essilor is the world's leading ophthalmic optics company. Say that three times quickly. It's a manufacturer of glass lenses with a presence in more than 100 countries worldwide. 2017 worldwide revenues of about $7.5 billion. 80% of its revenues come from the production and wholesale distribution of prescription lenses and optical instruments. 10% come from the sale of reading glasses and sunglasses. Its proprietary brands include Verilux, Crizal, and Transitions. Its licensed brands include Nikon, Kodak, and Optifog. Luxottica is a manufacturer of consumer glasses and sunglass frames. It's present in more than 150 countries worldwide. 2017 worldwide revenues in excess of $9 billion. Its proprietary brands include Ray-Ban, Oakley, Persol, Arnett, Vogue, Oliver People, and its licensed brands include every designer I can think of, alphabetically Armani, Chanel, Dolce & Gabbana, Prada, Ralph Lauren, Tiffany, Tory Burch, Valentino, and Versace. It's also the largest optical retailer in the United States with more than 8,000 stores branded as Sunglass Hut, Lens Crafters, and Pearl Vision. It operates optical services at Target and Sears. It has some lens laboratory capacity in the States. So this was a big deal. The deal was notified in more than 20 countries worldwide, including not only the EU, the US, China, Brazil, Canada, and other countries with what we think of as established pre-merger review schemes, but also in Colombia, Morocco, South Africa, and in other places. The final clearance, October 1st, from Turkey, 22 months after the announcement of the deal. In the EU, the deal was cleared on March 1, 2018, without conditions after a phase two review. So 14 months, that's actually about the same as the average duration of a significant transaction reviewed by DG Comp, as reported in the Dammit data. By the way, slight commercial, take a look at the Dammit release that's in your handout materials. The phase two review included responses from nearly 3,400 opticians as part of the market test. Coincidentally, on exactly the same day, the United States Federal Trade Commission cleared the deal, again without conditions, after a second request. That 13 months was about 30% longer than the 9.7 months, which was the average duration of significant deals closed or cleared during the first quarter of 2018. The U.S. Federal Trade Commission reviewed more than 1 million documents, interviewed more than 100 market participants, and reviewed documents and data from more than 20 third parties. A few months later, at the end of July 2018, MOFCOM cleared the deal with some limited conditions, and we are lucky to have Alexander Lunshof with us, the chief legal officer of Essilor, and he can describe the deal through his own lens. So obviously, this was a major task, the antitrust review. Let's start with the European Commission. What were the key issues under review?
Okay, thank you, Maya. The key issues in Europe were mainly conglomerate. I mean, in Europe, there were almost no horizontal overlap and very, very little vertical issues. In a few countries only. So the real issue was a conglomerate issue. And the main theory of harm came with the theory that the new company could leverage the strengths of the brands of Luxottica, especially Ray-Ban and a few others, to sell more lenses. And so that was really the predominant theory of harm. With also a very important question of is Ray-Ban a must-have product? And Ray-Ban has the market share basically of a Ray-Ban is much higher than of any other brand, but does it make it a must-have product? At the end of the day, the answer to that one was no, but it took us quite a long time to get there.
So, gee, Ray-Ban is a must-have. I'm surprised. What took so long?
Well, the first thing which took really long was the fact that there's almost no data about this market. It's a market with which the commission, at least, was not familiar. And for Essilor and Luxottica, it was really the first time we went to see DG Comp. And so all the questions needed really to get the elaboration of the data and the compilation of the data. That took quite a long time and therefore a pretty lengthy pre-notification process.
So in fact, the formal filing was not accepted until 8 months after the announcement of the deal, and it went to phase two on schedule. Was the long pre-notification part of the strategy, or did it just sort of work out that way?
No, it was part of the strategy to have at least a real in-depth pre-notification process and to really work with the authorities so that we could then really go quickly in phase one, preferably avoiding a phase two or having a short phase two. Well, needless to say, as companies, we would always have liked to file a little earlier, to do it in a quicker way, but it ended up that we filed and it was really accepted end of August 2017.
So you got the right result at the end of the day. Is there anything with the benefit of 2020 hindsight that you would have done differently with the commission?
Well, I think with the commission, there have been many, many discussions, very productive discussions, by the way, and trying to make them understand. I think one of the things that we could have handled better, or that also the commission could have handled better, is probably in establishing the questions that they were using in the market test. Because those questions were not always accurate or were not always very much to the point. And when you are sending out a questionnaire to about 40,000 independent and eye care professionals throughout Europe, not everybody understands the questions or can get to that. And therefore, really working those out would have probably helped us, would have probably helped the commission as well, more in depth.
Okay, let's go to the FTC. What were the key issues that the Federal Trade Commission was looking at in the States?
Well, in the States, it was really much more a vertical issue. As you mentioned, Luxottica has about 8,000 points of sales in the States. So the question was really much more vertical. How could we foreclose competitors in having access to the eye care professionals? Could we foreclose products of competitors within Luxottica stores? So those kind of questions really came first. We did have some more questions as well on the horizontal part in the sun area, but that was pushed away quite quickly. We did get some questions on laboratoriums. Essilor had entered into making its own lenses, and therefore the whole question was, did they do that with a view of only serving their own brands, or did they do that with a view of really competing with Essilor and all the laboratories of Essilor? And obviously, back to the documentary view that was discussed, I'm sure that there were many different opinions within Luxottica about what they should be doing with this. And therefore, in the discovery phase, certainly different type of documents that would evidence different routes. So a lot of questions about of the FTC about that.
Yes, so I had heard, because I talked to people, that there were some documents at Luxottica that were saying, yes, we're going to be a big wholesale laboratory, and we're going to be providing real competition. So a couple of questions there. One, how did you overcome that issue? And two, as a chief legal officer, how do you get your arms around preventing puffery and or other bad documents from being created in the first place?
That's a very important but a very difficult question. First, how do you overcome it? Well, it's a lot of explanation about which documents have been produced, where were they originating from, and which other documents exist, and mainly which economic theory is really applicable, and is there really a way that we could foreclose or not competitors? And there again, with the usual usual theories of the Guppy and the vertical arithmetics and the V Guppy and so on, it was all demonstrated that this would not occur. More importantly, going forward, how do you prevent this from happening? That is always a very, very difficult question in large organizations. It's very difficult to prevent someone in another part of the world to write or to say something and take some positions on what they think they can do or they should do. And we don't have sufficient internal control to prevent all that from happening. We can use, obviously, our best efforts. We are usually have procedures in place so that legal department has to review documentation, especially when it goes up into management committees and things like that. But it's not a zero-risk game. I mean, that doesn't exist.
Yeah, so the stuff that goes up to management committees, sure, you can get your handle on that, but when you're producing a million documents to the FTC, you can't possibly efficiently read all of them or review them in advance. So there's going to be some bad documents.
There's always a risk of having bad documents in a case, and it's very difficult to prevent that. Then you have to really assert, is this a policy of the group, or is this just some document that, or some statement by one person or by a few persons, but that doesn't dictate the policy of the group as such.
So in part it's the crazed middle management defense, and in part it's overcoming the bad document with what the real company policy is.
With what the real policy is, and with what really you can do from an economic perspective, and with the analysis from economists demonstrating whether or not this issue really exists or not.
So again, a 13-month review before the FTC, why did that take so long?
A million of documents, that's a lot of documents to review, as well for the FTC as for us.
Yeah, but once you certify your substantial compliance, then the statute says that the commission has 30 days to make up its mind to bring an action in court or not. Is that how it works in real life?
Well, not really. I mean, we all know that there is a discussion about a timing agreement in the U.S. pretty early on in a process like this one. So we tend in our case, there was quite some desire from the FTC not to get to that case, not to get to the certification, in order not to go into a legal defensive mode, but rather to work the issues out from a competitive perspective and analysis. And therefore, first we entered into a timing agreement. And at the end, when we were about to certify under that timing agreement, and the FTC still wanted a bit more time to issue some issues, there we got a revision, basically, of that. But coming to a point that when we certified, there was no doubt, and the issues had been dealt with. We did certify, and the FTC did issue its decision.
So, in Europe, when the European Commission reaches a conclusion, it issues a decision. If the FTC chooses to clear a deal, which it did here, it typically does not issue any decision. It just lets the deal go through. In this case, the Commission issued a statement that explained its reasoning, which is pretty rare. In fact, I think this was the first deal they'd done that in connection with for some time. Why do you think they issued their statement in this case?
Well, except that perhaps Liz would be better placed than me to answer that one. There were at least two things that I can think about. One is there was some coordination between the FTC and the EU and DG Comp, and so they made their announcement on the same date. And as the EU was announcing, there was perhaps a feeling on the American side that doing the same would be a good point. The second point is that there had been many complaints in Europe, in the US, in other countries, from competitors, from clients, from all kind of actors in the industry, some of which are very professional companies, large multinationals, and with structured complaints. Others are independent pop and mom shops, and that can have a variety of type of complaints. But if once you get a lot of that, perhaps there was a sense for the FTC to issue a decision to all this. But this is pure speculation on my part. I'm not vouching for the FTC.
So the agencies were clearly coordinating. Do you think that helped you or hurt you in the review process?
I think it helped us, and I think it's very important to coordinate, to rely on this coordination and to favor it anyway. So some of the authorities, they are really close to each other, others not. I mean, between Washington and Brussels, there is a constant flow and knowledge. They know each other pretty well. With other authorities, it's not exactly the same. But I think it does help to the extent of understanding the questions. It does help. It does help us companies that the authorities properly understand the market and properly understand the questions, and that is not easy. And when you have the authorities cooperating, there is a higher chance in achieving that. There is. Obviously, it forces the company to really be very consistent and to really be very coordinated as well. But that's part of the exercise.
Yours is a very global business, so that sort of makes sense. But 5 months later, MOFCOM came through and cleared the deal with some conditions. Can you talk about those conditions and the MOFCOM process, which is often viewed as being fairly opaque?
Yes, it is fairly opaque, if not totally opaque. The process, and just one more point on the previous thing, and then I get back to Marco. There is also a lot of authorities that are waiting for the EU and for the FTC to make their decision, to make their analysis, before they really come up with their own decision. In some cases, we even had one where it was before even starting investigating. We had one authority that was just telling us, well, we'll do whatever the EU has been doing. So we'll take the same decision, and you'll get the same decision in 5 days after they made their decision. Okay, fine. They did it, actually, end of the day. So you have a bit of wait-and-see policy of many authorities. And China is definitely one of those. They wait really until they have all the issues and they can see what has been going on in other jurisdictions. The process is quite opaque. The deadlines, phase one, phase two, phase three, does not mean much, because at the end of the day, anyway, they have the pull and refile system. So you have to start it all over again. And there is, it's in a way frustrating because we didn't get a real theory of harm. They were just telling us, well, there are some conglomerate questions, and that's it. We didn't really get to a theory of harm. At the end of the day, didn't seem that there were much competitive concerns as either. Now the Chinese authorities are not only in charge of competition, but they are also in charge of the industry. So they take also some other things into account.
So what were the remedies?
We had some behavioral remedies there for non-tying, keeping our products open to the opticians, so some non-exclusivity there, informing the Chinese authorities of future acquisitions, even though they are under the threshold. So those kind of remedies.
So no remedies elsewhere?
One in Turkey. Turkey, we had a specific horizontal issue, which was really specific to that country, on the sun glasses market. So that was the only structural remedy we took, where we are divesting an entity in Turkey.
So let me ask you the general question as a battle-scarred veteran. What advice do you have for general counsel who are facing multi-jurisdictional reviews of this kind of scale?
Well, coordination is the first thing. Choose very well your advisors and your counsels. That's another point, which is perhaps easy in Europe and in the US, where you have reputable firms and reputable economists and so on. In many other countries, this is really an issue. In China, it's really important to make sure that you have people that have access to the MOFCOM or to the SAMR, as it's called now, so that you can get some understanding, and that applies as well in other jurisdictions. And then really coordinate it from a worldwide perspective in order to make sure that there is your coherence, and in order to make sure that you convey a good understanding to all these authorities.
So one thing I've learned over the years is to try to keep people on time for lunch. So I think we should thank Alexander for his clear vision on this matter, and please join us outside for lunch.
Thank you.